I'm really, really pleased to be able to announce our next speaker. One important note, this was meant to be a two-way conversation as we had with Bhaskar and Sarah earlier. Sean Jacobs, who is a professor here, he's a founding editor of a blog called Africa is a Country. He's written a lot on cricket and South African origin. He's done a lot on sports. He's a really tremendous guy, and so I'm giving him a big build-up just to say that sadly he's not here because he has a really bad sore throat. And I know he wasn't fronting because I talked to him this morning. He sounded just awful. So he's really sorry he could not be here, but I'd encourage you to look him up and check out his work. Again, though, I'm really, really delighted to be able to introduce Dave Zirin. He's a good friend and a very important figure at The Nation magazine. He doesn't like when I do that. I'll embarrass him. But yeah, nobody in the entire pantheon of The Nation was read more at thenation.com last year than Dave Zirin's work. And he writes a lot, and his work is wildly popular. He sort of pioneered. I mean, someone earlier was very impressive, knew the year that the magazine was founded. Anyone remember again? 1865, so 152 years old. Now, Dave's getting on in years, but he's not that old. So Dave Zirin is the first sports editor in the entire 152-year history of The Nation magazine. It's quite a distinction, but it's one that he's carried not just with pride, but he's really transformed it. And I don't know, many of you here might not care at all about sports. Some may love him, some may hate him. But what Dave has done is he's really pioneered a new way of reporting on sports. Not only has he taken class and race and gender and intersectionality into the analysis, but he's really, really focused on raising up stories and voices of people who you don't read, even in good publications. He really, really is determined and dedicated to not just doing good reporting and finding stories that need to be told, but bringing in other younger writers. He's very, very good at nurturing and trying to find. It's sad. I'm always saying, Dave, I'm too busy, but he's constantly emailing me pitches from young writers. He really feels committed to helping support and who he thinks has really good stories for the magazine. So he's really excited to be here today. He's written, I had his bio here. He's written 8 books. He spent the last summer, in Brazil, writing on not the Olympic Games, but on the resistance to the Olympics, on the opposition, on the strikes in the street from all the people who were just so upset that so much money was going into these big stadiums, displacing residents while people were starving in the shanties. So Dave spent a lot of time writing about that. He's written 2 books on Brazil, so he knows a lot about a lot of things. What he's going to talk about now, though, is again the work he's done, how he's brought politics into sports. And the one more thing I'd say that's really important is that sports are a really good entry point to talking to people who don't agree with all of us on all the many issues on which we share share consensus. He's able to he could write an article about LeBron James and someone's going to read that who couldn't care, doesn't even know what the left is, but Dave might be able to make a point there that's valuable about race and about class that someone who's unconverted, if you will really take to heart and can really kind of change the way they think about things. So we at The Nation have been really, really pleased and fortunate to have Dave writing for us, and he's done a lot to kind of build bridges to other communities. And I'm talking too much about his work. I don't want to steal his thunder. He's still busy on his phone, but I think he's ready for you now. And so please join me in welcoming Dave Zirin.
How y'all doing? First of all, I just really want to thank Peter. Peter, that was very kind. I miss Sean. Sean's an amazing person. That's who I was going to be up here with. But as Peter said, Sean is not fronting, so keep that very much in mind. He is sick. And now I'm going to speak to you all about why Russell Westbrook should be the MVP this year in the NBA. So I got about 45 minutes on that, and then we'll have time for 5 minutes of questions. No, that's not what I'm going to talk about at all. Now, I will just talk for a little bit, then we'll open it up, folks, have any questions about the collision of sports and politics. And what I really want to talk about is about how this beat of sports and politics has changed in the time I've been writing for The Nation, which has been about 12 years that I've been doing this for The Nation. And in that time, it's changed pretty dramatically, particularly in the last 6 months. And I get the feeling that what I'm about to say is gonna sound familiar to people whose beat is far away from the world of sports, and you're covering all sorts of other things. So I wanna start though with a story all the way back in 2005. I mean, you can't imagine what the world was like back then. We didn't have a raging jackass in the White House, so everything was, it was just a little bit different. We just had a jackass, actually. It was George W. Bush. But he wasn't a raging jackass, just your run-of-the-mill jackass. And at that time, I wrote a book. I just started writing for The Nation, and I wrote a book called What's My Name, Fool? Sports and Resistance in the United States. And the cover is a big picture of Muhammad Ali's face, like going like this, like, like a big Ali face. And I was doing a talk in a city that, you know, I don't want to name. All right, it was Philadelphia. And I was in Philly, and I went into this, you know, very, you know, anarchist, collectively run bookstore. And I walked in and I said, hey, I'm here to do the What's My Name, Fool talk. My name is Dave Zirin. And this very pleasant young guy with a lot of pierces behind the counter, he looked at me and he said, but you're white. And I said, well, yeah, last I checked. And he said, but isn't that you on the cover of the book? And I had to be like, no, that's Muhammad Ali, not me. And I remember looking around this bookstore and seeing that they had these amazing posters up everywhere of people like from Emma Goldman to Malcolm X, like all the resistance heroes you could possibly imagine, and thinking, my goodness, they don't know the name and the face of the most famous draft resistor in the history of war, is who Muhammad Ali is. And why is that history so not integrated into this space that is supposed to be about resistance and sports? And that to me has been sort of like my compass going forward. Like this idea that for people on the left, certainly, that you can't look at sports as something like dirty and wrong and evil and you know, something that you watch at 3 a.m. on a small TV in your bathroom, and you know, something that you should be ashamed for liking. You know, someone's knocking on the door and it's like, close the door, I'm watching sports, like something that's embarrassing. And similarly, sports have this incredible power as an ideological Trojan horse. And I believe this so much in 2005. And I'm shifting a little bit on this in 2017, and that's what I'm going to talk to you all about. But 2005, this is what I'm thinking. I'm thinking like sports is a way to actually reach people and speak to people about ideas that they otherwise wouldn't reject. So you might be able to talk to somebody and talk to them about Muhammad Ali, but what you're really having a discussion about is about racism, about Islam, about Vietnam, about imperialism. And because you're talking about Muhammad Ali, somehow that discussion becomes easier. Certainly for me, as someone who's both Jewish and cares very deeply about Palestinian rights, the difficulty in engaging people of my particular tribe, if you will, about the issue of Palestinian rights is not easy. The figurative, if not literal, walls go up right away. And yet when you speak about things like the plight of Palestinian soccer players or the racism in some Israeli soccer clubs, you find that you're able to actually build that bridge. And all of a sudden they're listening in a way they maybe weren't listening before. And I could go down the list and tell you stories about how we've done that at The Nation or articles I've written about everything from, you know, LGBT rights. I mean, about trans athletes back then, what we were debating was, do you write transgender or transgendered? Because we weren't sure what the appropriate phraseology was. But just the mere fact of talking about trans athletes 10 years ago allowed us to begin to have a discussion about the rights of trans people, period. And when you talk about trans athletes, you also begin to raise the question about why we even have gender segregation in sports, and why we choose to even organize sports in a way where you have boys over here and girls over there. So it opens yourself up to much bigger discussions when you talk about sports. And one issue certainly that I think sports allows for a discussion where otherwise it wouldn't exist, and I've had this experience on campuses time and again, is speaking about rape and rape culture. And when you have that discussion and you're talking about the football team on campus, or you're talking about fraternities and athletes, particularly athletic fraternities, and what people are allowed to get away with because they are athletes, and how that either filters down to the campus or how what's happening on the campus filters down into the locker room, it allows for a different kind of discussion where all of a sudden, instead of a discussion where, you know, you're trying to figure out how you can speak to people beyond the, you know, very well-meaning choir of folks who want to stand up to rape culture, all of a sudden, I find myself in a room with the entire football team with no coaches in there, and we're having a discussion about rape culture. And that's a different kind of dynamic, was what I mean by the ideological Trojan horse. And just a quick story that I'll tell about the ideological Trojan horse and how helpful it can be was right after I started at The Nation, the first article actually I ever wrote that was in The Nation was about a gentleman by the name of Pat Tillman. Pat Tillman played for the NFL, turned down a multi-million dollar contract to be an Army Ranger, and he was killed in Afghanistan under very, very suspicious circumstances. Now, most of the articles that had been written about Pat Tillman after he died, remember, this is before Twitter, before Facebook, before 1,000 people had 1,000 takes on something before you could even take a breath. But at that time, all that was written about Pat Tillman was in the established sports magazines, and it was all about Pat Tillman as hero. That was the narrative, Pat Tillman as hero. And you know, he's the reason why we gotta keep on fighting and fight for freedom in Iraq and Afghanistan. And there were a couple of articles on very left-wing blogs, what have you, that were like, Pat Tillman, you know, why are we mourning a war criminal, et cetera. And you know, he was an Army Ranger, therefore he was this, you know, agent of imperialism overseas. And I wrote an article for The Nation where I spoke to people who knew Pat Tillman, his friends, and found out that this guy was like an extraordinary human being, like someone who read Noam Chomsky, someone who was challenging in his mind the ideas of war as he was fighting in a war. And I wrote about not just the tragedy of his death, but about the fact that blood was on the hands of this government, Bush, Cheney, that they're the reasons this exceptional person died. And I wrote this before it even got out that he had died by friendly fire. Like that was something that wasn't even known yet that came out later, that he died by his own troops. I had written it before we knew that not only had he read Noam Chomsky, but he was writing letters to Noam Chomsky and trying to meet with Noam Chomsky to try to figure out, you know, what he thought about the war and what he should do as a vet who believed in his own words that the war in Iraq was illegal. So got that before the curve in terms of like that Pat Tillman was somebody who people who want to end this war should actually be holding up as a hero and should be holding up as the ultimate condemnation of a Bush administration that was willing to kill thousands of people for a war of choice for oil, a racist war. And so I wrote this article, and then I found myself in a bar in New York, probably 5 minutes from where we are right now, just around the corner. And in that bar is a person who used to write for The Nation, who left because he decided he loved the wars overseas too much to write for a publication like The Nation. Did anybody guess who this person was? Just curious, I don't even know how, if this person even has much currency in 2017. Yeah, thank you Fagan, who was in our group before. But Christopher Hitchens, raise your hand if you've heard of Christopher Hitchens. Okay, Christopher Hitchens, and by the way, I find it fascinating that not every hand was up. That doesn't say anything about y'all, that says something about, to me, Christopher Hitchens. I'll say that, because he as George, it's wrong to speak ill of the dead, no it's not. As George Galloway once said about Christopher Hitchens, he said he was like a butterfly in reverse, like somebody who went from being this beautiful creature and converted into a slug. Now, Christopher Hitchens also, it has to be said, is one of the great writers of his time in terms of erudition, wit, phrasing. Like, if you just want to study the form of writing, by all means, read Christopher Hitchens, particularly his Nation columns before he went pro-war. Those in particular are better if you like your form with your content. But just an amazing writer. And I'm in a bar around the corner from here. You know, I'm a young writer. I just published my first piece at The Nation on Pat Tillman. And Christopher Hitchens is in the bar. And if you know anything about Christopher Hitchens, you would know that this scene that I'm gonna describe sounds very much like Christopher Hitchens. He had a big cigarette in his mouth, but there's no smoking in bars, so it was unlit. And he had a drink in each hand. And he was drinking while, it was amazing, shifting the cigarette from one side of his mouth to the other. It was amazing. And he was on it, he only had the two drinks because he was on his way to sit at a table with a group of very young students who he was kind of holding court with. I assume they went to NYU, New School, somewhere in this neighborhood. And I couldn't help myself, because I was feeling kind of chesty from having published my first article in The Nation. And I went up to him and I said, yo, Christopher Hitchens, my name's Dave. I write about sports in The Nation magazine. And this really did happen. He looked up at me and he said, did you write that piece about Pat Tillman? And I said, I was like stunned. And I said, yeah. And he said, that was the finest piece of anti-war writing that magazine has put out. And I was like shocked. You know, it was like this 1,000-word piece about this football player, and the Nation had done remarkable reporting on Iraq. But the reason why he liked it was because it wasn't this story decrying the aims of the war in beautiful and political fashion, which the Nation did brilliantly during the Bush years. It was a story about a guy, a good person with a family who was killed. And it was a story that spoke to me in a way that was deep from talking to his family and friends. So I sort of couldn't help myself. So I said to Christopher Hitchens, as I said, that's really kind of you. So you like the story of Pat Tillman? And he said, yeah, it's very moving. And I said, well, you know, he'd still be alive if it wasn't for that war that you cheerled. And then he stops and he looks at me. And he said, I read your article closely and I saw you did slip in a line there about Iraq not having weapons of mass destruction. So you believe that liberal tripe. And I said to him, I said, come on. Not even Dick Cheney is making the argument anymore that Iraq had weapons of mass destruction. And he looks at me, looks up and down, and he spits his cigarette at me. And it hits me right in the chest and falls to the ground. And I was like, oh my God. Did that just happen? Like, I've been stunned. Like, my God. And I gotta be honest with you. Like, and I'm not just trying to say this like to be all whatever, because I hate toxic masculinity machismo more than anybody you've ever met in your life. But like, I've been tear gassed doing stories. I've been hit by police. I've been in very scary situations among soccer hooligans. I can tell you, I have never been more stunned than when this little cigarette hit me in the chest and fell to the ground. I was frozen like this. And then he turned around, went to his seat, made some comment to the people. They all pointed at me and laughed. And then they started drinking. And that's the whole story. And the whole point of that story, other than it's a fun story to tell, is that to me, it ended up being a vindication. And a vindication of this idea that anybody could be reached, even Christopher Hitchens, through using sports as this kind of a lens. Now, fast forward to the last year. And the Tillman story is a story, I'll say, you know, without humility, of being ahead of the curve and being like, there's something here with Pat Tillman. This is a story about me being behind the curve and about how you adjust to that. The most biggest thing that happened to me in the last year in terms of my writing was, of course, this San Francisco quarterback makes a decision to take a knee before the national anthem by the name of Colin Kaepernick. And then all of a sudden, these protests are spreading from Beaumont, Texas, to Prince George's County, Maryland, to Seattle, Washington. People are taking part in it all over the place. Soccer players, volleyball players, cheerleaders, band members. The craziest thing was this one band in Oakland actually played the Star Spangled Banner while taking a knee on the field, including the person with the tuba. Now, I don't care what those football players did that game, and I don't know, but there's nothing more athletic to me than playing a tuba on one knee. And the image of it was just unbelievable. It was like the heroism of the band is not something you usually get when you talk about sports. It was unbelievable. And this story just exploded. And it also proved stuff that I'd been trying to argue for a long time, which is that when athletes are political, particularly Black athletes speaking out on the question of racism, it has the power to, and these are just the phrases I use a lot, it has the power to sever segregation and puncture privilege, in that it has the power to bring discussions into areas, namely white areas, that people have the privilege, for lack of a better word, to not have to discuss. We don't have to discuss police brutality, or you see a police officer on a dark night and actually you feel more nervous, not less nervous. But like, this discussion gets imposed in these spaces by athletes, and people have been doing it over the last several years, from LeBron James, Carmelo Anthony, Serena Williams, but nobody like Colin Kaepernick. Now, here's the problem though. When Colin Kaepernick did this, if you had asked me to name the top 30 athletes who would make an electric sports stand and blow people's minds from coast to coast, if you'd asked me to make that list of 30 names, I guarantee you I would not have had Colin Kaepernick in that top 30. So immediately, I'm behind. Like, holy crap. You know, I know who Colin Kaepernick is because I'm a damn sports fan, but who the hell is Colin Kaepernick? And why the hell is he doing this? And having to play catch up on that question was an experience unto itself. And what I found out was, you know, the first thing you do in a situation like this is you look at somebody's social media feed these days. And so what I found out looking at his Twitter and looking at his Facebook, looking at his Instagram, like, wow, yeah, the reason why he never was on my radar is that, you know, he had never been someone to do hashtag Black Lives Matter, to do hashtag, you know, hands up, hashtag, excuse me, hashtag any of the major things that had been going on. But what he had been doing under my radar screen entirely was posting long form articles about things like mass incarceration and police brutality, like long journal style stuff. So clearly what Colin Kaepernick had been doing in the last year was that he was in the lab, so to speak. He was in the woodshed. He was trying to figure out how he could become educated enough to not just make a stand, but back it up. And then I had to read everything that he read, which is what I did then. And then, only then, could I start actually writing about what it was and what it meant and why it mattered. And by the way, the only reason why any of it mattered, just putting this out there, was because of journalists. Because when it started, Colin Kaepernick, actually, people forget this, did not take a knee. It started with him being a backup quarterback sitting on a bench. And nobody even noticed that he was sitting. And it was actually, it was a journalist who went up to him and said, I would love to be able to ask you why you're sitting. And then it was like a dam breaking. Because he was like, oh, you want to know why I'm sitting? Let me tell you. And then it was, this is a country that X, Y, and Z. And he just went through an argument about systemic racism. And it had this kind of catalytic effect. And the reason why it had this effect, and this was what all, then becomes the question of like, okay, everybody's writing about this. Where do I find my niche? And we were talking about this in our group before. It's like, what's our take that we can put on this? How do we find something unique that we can develop? And so when I was thinking about it, I was like, okay, the question that needs to be answered is not like, oh, there's this tradition of athletes speaking out because everybody's doing that. The question is, why is Colin Kaepernick connecting in such a catalytic and electric way when other athletes did not? Even recently, people like LeBron, Carmelo wearing the I Can't Breathe t-shirts before games. Why is this connecting? And when I looked at it, I said, okay, really think for a second. Why is this connecting? Why is this connecting? And the thing that came across to me most clearly was thinking about Muhammad Ali. And Muhammad Ali is very special in my mind today because a year ago, as Peter reminded me, I was speaking right at this conference and I spent half my time on stage going through my phone because he'd been admitted to the hospital and I was like, there's all this breaking news about his health. That was a year ago, right here, was when he passed. And the thing about Ali was looking at it was like, okay, what's the difference between Muhammad Ali, LeBron James, Colin Kaepernick, looking at all of this? And what Muhammad Ali did was he didn't say, okay, we need to build a bridge between everybody who loves the war in Vietnam and everybody who hates the war in Vietnam. And we need to all come together in a room and figure out how we can all get along. That's not what Ali did. He took a side and he said, the war in Vietnam is wrong, and I'm going to fight for that position. And then you look at what Chris Paul, Carmelo Anthony, LeBron James, some of the NBA players, what were they saying? Is they were talking about building bridges. And there's nothing wrong with talking about building bridges. That's your politics. That's what you do. But it's not the same thing as saying no justice, no peace, which is what Muhammad Ali was saying, and it's what Colin Kaepernick was saying. They were saying, I do not want your peace, and I do not want your bridge if I cannot have justice. And that's what had the catalytic effect that electrified itself throughout the world of sports. Now, fast forward to today, and I'll end here. I'm sorry for going on so long. I do apologize. But to take to this moment right now is one of the things that I'm definitely struggling with in this era of Trump is that even Kaepernick taking a knee all of a sudden feels quaint, given that was way back when, in the Obama years, when he started doing that, in that previous era. And what's so difficult about this moment right now is I was writing about sports because I felt like all the crimes that Bush was doing and all the things that Obama was doing that I found incredibly objectionable, it's like it was all papered over and tried to make look nice. And, you know, it's just like, oh, everything, nothing to see here, just people dying from drone attacks, nothing to see here, just, you know, supporting a neo-fascist state in Israel, nothing to see here, the looting of sub-Saharan Africa, nothing to see here, police brutality. And sports, I thought, saw as a way to break through that shiny veneer and say, no, this is the reality of what's happening. There's no shiny veneer with Trump. There is no shiny veneer. Everything is political. Every day feels like forever. Like, it reminds me, living here now is like, in this country, there's this famous quote from Oscar Wilde about being in prison. And he said, being in prison every day feels like a year. And in this particular year, the days are long. So every day is a year. And in those years, the days are long. And it's like right now, it's like every day just feels like, wait a minute. I woke up this morning upset about one thing, and now there's five more things. I was coming here to sit down. I looked at my phone about the damn healthcare vote and Keystone Pipeline, and it's like, oh, head of the FBI is heading to the White House right now. It's like, what the hell is happening? And in a climate like that, what's the role of sports, and what's the role of the sports writer? What's the role of sports when right now, I used to be the political sports writer, now I'm a political sports writer. Because their sports writers now have their own hashtag, stick to sports, which is their ironic response to people who tell them to just shut up and stick to sports. Now, on one hand, I can take some pride in feeling like I helped open up some space for other people to be political in the sports world. But on the other hand, there's also no denying that so many people in the sports world are being political, not because of me or not because of Colin Kaepernick, but because they're so incensed about what's happening in our world right now with this Agent Orange jackass in the White House, and they're trying to figure out, how do I use sports to resist? Because they want to resist too. So what's the role of a nation sports writer in a world where ESPN sports writers are shouting resistance? What's the role of a culture writer or a music writer to speak to Gabrielle, who is in our group, who hopefully isn't here since she already had to endure me? Are you here, Gabrielle? Oh, she is in the back. I'm sorry, Gabrielle. More me. I see Fagan here. I feel bad for everybody who's in the group that they're just double dose of me here. But just this idea of like, what's the role of people who aren't writing about the daily tumult that's going through this country and trying to find our writing about art, culture, sports, history, music, and shedding light on a political world that, frankly, right now is blaring like a spotlight and burning out our retinas. And figuring out how to do that, I think is, I have no easy answers for it, but I think it's gonna be the challenge for all of us as journalists going forward, because we are absolutely, positively, without a question, in uncharted territory right now. The only thing I will say is this, is that you have been branded, I have been branded an enemy of the state for daring to consider yourself a journalist. Wear that shit proudly, because this state needs more enemies. That's
Thank
all.
You, Dave. So we have a few minutes for questions. If anyone wants to line up, you see our mics. I always have some for Dave if no one wants to be the first. I think I see someone heading there.
Is it me? Oh.
Do you want to start, please?
Sure. My name is Danielle Smith, and I'm originally from South Jersey, so I, of course, root all Philly teams. And I graduated from Columbia last May, and I guess my question would be, I know, and we do this with celebrities too, but we have a tendency with athletes to sometimes expect them to be political and even to politicize them in ways they don't do themselves, like thinking of Cam Newton as an example. I know when he first started, a lot of us loved him for being sort of unapologetically black. And then more recently, he said some things we didn't like. Mm-hmm. So I'm just wondering how you sort of maybe balance and resist the temptation to politicize people who maybe aren't doing it themselves or don't need to be. Mm-hmm.
That's a great question. And it's particularly important as it's two things you got to keep in mind. The first is particularly as a white male sports writer, to not expect black athletes to take the weight and risk their careers while I get to sit back and write about it. So two things I do to, but then you also have to face the reality that if you want to, like, I've written a book that's a history of political athletes. If it was just the history of political white male athletes, that's a pamphlet. That's not a book. And so there are two things. One, historically, you have to be able to explain why it is that it's oppressed groups, black, women, LGBT, brown, like why these are the folks who have been the political athletes. Like there's actually a historical reason why that's the case. And you have to be able to explain that to people. And I won't go through it all, but it has to do with, you know, meritocracy, the founding of sports, the way it was really for white male young immigrants to be acculturated into America. And anytime a person who was black, female, LGBT was able to show themselves to excel on this very public stage, it actually had huge political repercussions, whether the athlete was political or not. Okay. So to take it to then what you do with that is, first of all, I've tried to consistently write about white athletes needing to take the weight. And so if people are upset, like, and that being upset about racism or police brutality or sexism or homophobia, that should be a collective anger, not just the anger of the people who are affected. And particularly in the case with athletes, and there's a powerful ideological cudgel that you can use as a writer here, because anyone who's played sports, have you played sports?
No, I'm very uncoordinated.
Oh, okay, well.
I watch.
Okay, good. Well. Being uncoordinated, as I can tell you, should never be a barrier for playing sports. But it's to say that what you get a lot from coaches is this rhetoric that we're a family. That's a constant rhetoric in sports. We're a family. This locker room, we're a family. And it's like, how can we be a family if a whole group of that family doesn't care that a whole other group of that family is very upset because somebody who looks like them or a family member of them or them themselves has been subject to some form of oppression, what have you. So. That's the first thing right there. The second thing is absolutely positively, you gotta let athletes speak for themselves. That's the second thing, is that as a journalist writing about political people, and it doesn't matter if we're just talking about athletes, but with athletes in particular, it's like you let them talk. And more often than not, they come to you because they have something to say, or they're going to social media with something to say. And then it's not about me, the journalist, pressuring them to speak. It's about me helping amplify what their message is. And so playing a role almost of allyship to their politicization as opposed to trying to actively get them in trouble. And then one last thing to say about it is that you mentioned celebrity in general. And I think it's so important to differentiate when athletes speak out, to say when movie stars speak out or when Lady Gaga speaks out or something like that, because it matters more when athletes speak out. It always has mattered more. It matters more when Colin Kaepernick does something than when George Clooney does something. And some of that has to do with the tradition of people like Muhammad Ali, but some of it has to do, I really do think, because we realize that these athletes, you know, they have a very limited time in the spotlight. So when they're speaking out, they're actually risking something. And with that risk, with that dare that they're speaking out. James Baldwin once said that America is a country devoted to the death of the paradox, meaning like if you're an athlete, that's all you can be. And it's like, so if there are these people who are actually, like they're going to betray that paradox and speak out, it has an electric effect that's different from, I would argue, anything else in the culture.
Could I just, do you think that's, I mean, this is a deeper question, but do you think that's why Kaepernick's having a harder time getting picked up?
Oh yeah, he's being blackballed right now.
You think so?
Absolutely. I've written about it for The Nation. No, he's being, what's called, we were talking about this before, what's called collusion or tortious interference, which is what Donald Trump just did when he was, but this is good though. Like I got to call Donald Trump a jackass on ESPN, which was very exciting because they were asking me about Donald. I was on Dan Le Batard's television show, and this was just a couple days ago, Peter. It's on the Facebook. I was very proud of this. I put it on Facebook. They said they played the clip of Donald Trump, people probably saw it at this rally in Kentucky, bragging about the fact that Colin Kaepernick's without a job. You know, it's just red meat for his audience of, you know, elderly geriatrics, of him like joking, like, because it's red meat. It's like, oh, this guy with an afro hates racism. Isn't it hilarious that he doesn't have a job? And it's like, and it's because NFL owners are scared of me, ha ha ha. And so they played the clip and they said to me, so Dave, like, what do you think Colin Kaepernick has a chance of getting signed by a team? And I said, I can't even talk about that, because just to hear that jackass, a president of the United States, brag about somebody not being able to find work, I mean, that's so disgusting. And that's what I mean also by uncharted territory. So I was talking to the sports writer the other day, And I said, for the podcast, the Nation Magazine podcast, I should say, that's the Nation that I do, which newly with the Nation, is I was talking to this sports writer for Bleacher Report about Kaepernick and would he get signed. And he was talking about how he used that phrase that I've been parroting here, uncharted territory, and not knowing what's going to happen with Kaepernick because no one knows what's happening because of Trump and all this stuff. And I said to him, like, are you saying to me that the question of whether or not Colin Kaepernick has a backup job on the Carolina Panthers is dependent upon whether or not Donald Trump is arrested for treason? And he was like, sadly, yeah, that's where we are. So these are weird times in which we live in.
Great question, thank you. Sir, I can't see you, but please.
Hi, my name is Jabril.
Hey, Jabril.
I go to UCLA. I have two questions, both of which are probably going to be poorly articulated, so sorry in advance. Wow. But the first one is, you talked about what was the difference between Muhammad Ali and LeBron James and Carmelo and Chris Paul and like Colin Kaepernick, and you said it was because like Muhammad Ali and Colin Kaepernick like took stances, but have you also considered like the fact that they were both rejecting like very heavily like American traditions? Mm-hmm. So like Muhammad Ali was like rejecting like a draft, mm-hmm. and then like Colin Kaepernick was like not standing for the national anthem, and like I'm sure you've like mm-hmm. thought of that. So I just wanted to know like how you mm-hmm. think like that fits into the equation of like how they're received publicly mm-hmm. And intergenerationally. Mm-hmm. And then the other question, which I'm trying to remember. No. You can answer that while I think of the second question.
That's a terrific question. I mean, I want to jump on that question. So you could not even listen to my answer and think about the second question while I answer that, because it's such a good question. One, yes, absolutely. What did Muhammad Ali said? He said, damn America and goddamn the money. I mean, can you imagine an athlete or anybody saying, God damn the money? I mean, it was an amazing thing. And he put his belt in the garbage. I mean, so this is Muhammad Ali rejecting so many tropes. I mean, but Muhammad Ali was doing that even when he was Cassius Clay. Like, even having a heavyweight champion talk about how pretty he was, when being a boxing champion at the time, you were supposed to be this avatar of very toxic masculinity. And he was much more this avatar of, look how pretty I am. And people didn't even, that was like for the boxing press or for white boxing, it was like, did not compute. You know, it was blowing people's skulls before he said anything about the Nation of Islam or the draft. He was already driving the traditional folks out of their mind. So the Americanism thing is very important. But another thing is very important too, is that the method of protest of Muhammad Ali and Colin Kaepernick is very much in the tradition of Malcolm X and the later years of Martin Luther King's life, in that they, and I'm using some of the words of Howard Bryant, who's a terrific writer for ESPN here, if people want to read his stuff, is that they refused to talk about racism while also simultaneously absolving white guilt. Literally white guilt, not white guilt as in feeling bad, but actual guilt for the transatlantic slave trade, Jim Crow, and the rest of it. And that is something that the majority of this country has always responded to with tremendous anger and violence. It's like, you can talk about racism. I'm not talking about like the 17% deplorable, you know, wannabe Klan members. I'm talking about like for the broad swath of white America. It's like, you can talk about racism, but only if it's in the context of talking about racism as if it's the past, as if it's a misunderstanding, as if it's a problem of communication skills. You know, can we all just get along? And that was actually most of Dr. King's life, is that's how he talked about racism, about appealing to the best angels of our nature. And he would speak about how racism actually harms, I think he had a speech where he actually said racism harms white people more than black people because of how it poisons them, their souls. You know, so it was all very much in this language of redemption. And in the last couple of years of Dr. King's life, it was much more, fuck that. You know, there is a legacy of slavery and violence that this country has produced, and I stand against it, and then he's shot and killed. Just like that. So there's this way in which we talk about race that Ali and Kaepernick did, that it connects to what you said about Americanism, but it's also about who you choose to absolve. Mm-hmm. and who you do not.
For more information on like MLK's later years, I would recommend y'all read something called The Crisis in America's Cities, which is something that he wrote in 1967, so which is the year before he died. But my second question was it's about like what you said earlier about how white athletes should like kind of takes at least a part of the burden in this like fight against like racial injustice like in sports. And so like I wanted to know like that's kind of a difficult and nuanced conversation because like it's important for like white people to speak out about racism but not for them to be the spokespeople. Mm-hmm. So like how have you seen like white athletes or have you seen white athletes like try to reconcile that struggle of like I want to speak up in a way that is like directly accessible to the public and is going to be like widely have a wide influence, but like at the same time, I don't want to be that person in the screen. Like what does that look like in practice for white athletes?
Well, two ways I answer that. The first is definitely look at the statement put out by Megan Rapinoe of USA Soccer when she started to kneel in solidarity with Kaepernick. And she put out a long statement that was really beautiful and nuanced that spoke exactly about that issue. About the need to do it because she wanted to take some of the weight and criticism off of Kaepernick, but she is not putting herself forward as the voice against racism or anything like that. So there's that. There's some good modeling happening, led by Megan Rapinoe. Also Chris Long, who's a white guy, played for the New England Patriots, who's not going to the White House, and how he responded to that, are both good instances of modeling of how people are wrestling with that, like in sports, like how to be part of the struggle without acting like your center stage of the struggle. And similarly, a place that I can tell you, like where it's very controversial is in the LGBT athletic community, there's an organization called Athlete Ally that's led by a straight guy who's always front and center on the news when there are issues of LGBT athletes, and it rubs a lot of people the wrong way, in a big way. It's like, wait a minute, you know, create the space. But I'll also say this though, when you're talking about from having interviewed a lot of these guys, when you're talking about big time athletes, and I've asked this of, and I'm talking about like male NBA, NFL, MLB players, and just asking them straight up, it's like, do you want your white teammates to speak up? Are they speaking up too much? Like I use a lot of the language that we use in the left, for example, like, are you worried about them using up too much oxygen, taking up too much space? Oftentimes, these guys are so beleaguered, they would be like, they're like, please speak up, for God's sakes. Like, it's just absurd how much heat I get on a daily basis. I would love for my white teammates to get this heat. Like, let them take it. Take center stage, please, by all means. Let me support them for a minute. And I always found that very interesting because it's so not what we would think based on some of the experiences that we have, I'm sure, on our colleges, talking about who gets to speak for who and those discussions. It's like, for the folks in the locker room, it's like, they just want help. They want to not be Atlas with the world on their shoulders. They want other people taking the weight.
Thank you.
Thank you for those terrific questions. We're gonna have four more questions. We're gonna try
I'll keep answers shorter so we get to everybody.
Yeah, thank you, please.
Do you say please keep your answers shorter?
Well, I was actually.
You're like, please.
Please speak, please keep your answers shorter.
Hi, I'm Kara. I go to Medill at Northwestern and I premise this question as a New England Patriots fan. I'm so sorry, I know, I'm sorry. To your point about Kaepernick and other athletes who take political action, it seems like there is a lot of opportunity to comment on it from a journalistic perspective. And then there are athletes like Tom Brady and coaches like Bill Belichick who also have somewhat political actions that are not necessarily supportive of those that Colin Kaepernick and others are pursuing. And my question to you is, why is it that the media doesn't seem to hold those athletes and coaches as accountable as they have been for people like Colin Kaepernick?
The easy answer is just to say, you know, good to be white and good to be right wing because the media less likely to go after you for that. But with those two folks in particular, it's actually more complicated because the thing about Tom Brady and Bill Belichick that just drives me batty is the lack of courage to actually stand behind what they think. I mean, Tom Brady, clearly a Donald Trump supporter, had the hat in his locker. Bill Belichick writes a handwritten letter, you know, praising Donald Trump that Donald Trump reads the night before the election. But when they were both asked, and they're asked by a lot of folks, like, what do you actually think? It's like, whoa, you've got teammates who are Muslims here. It's like, what do you think? What's up with that? Like, what do you guys talk about in the locker room? They're not touching it with a 10, 15-foot pole. You know, that they're like being the most Alex Rodriguez, you know, I'm just here to play one game at a time, good Lord willing, play one game at a time. And then Tom Brady is like, hey, look, I have new pajamas that, you know, you can buy for $3,000. And they, you know, there's no there. And I think for a lot of reporters, and I'll include myself in this, it's like, there's only so many times you can write about why won't they actually say what they think before that well gets dry. You know, it's like there has to be some sort of content there. And they have been so disciplined in not giving that content. And that's what makes it difficult. And it also makes it, I think, very, to me, it should amplify the courage of Colin Kaepernick, that because he could have very easily have just been like, I'm kneeling, it's personal, what have you. But he chose to actually explain, to explore the studio space, if you will, of why it is he cared about racism, police brutality. And yeah, that's not what they're doing.
Thank you.
No problem.
Thank you.
Grace? Hi, my name is Grace. I go to high school in Washington, D.C.
What? Where do you go?
Duke Ellington School of the Arts, where I study theater.
Oh, man. My wife teaches at Wilson.
Oh, okay. Yeah. We're in Northwest, but they're on the other side.
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
All right, guys. All right.
Sorry. Yeah.
After the session.
So my question, so you brought this up earlier, the space for trans students in professional sports. For example, like Mack Beggs, a trans wrestler yep. from Texas who's being made to play against the girls and is winning, and now Texas is upset because they yep. made a boy play the girls. So what is the next move that needs to be made for the like trans identity to be normalized and have a space in professional mainstream sports, and also to remove that modifier of trans and just let athletes be athletes?
Well, it's a great question, and this is something that the NCAA actually has really good guidelines on. I mean, which is, they said that they want people to be able to try out and play on the teams of the gender identity that they see themselves. And that's the space where they're allowed to go, and that's the space where they're allowed to play. And I think that's the number one way to start the normalization process. They also have pretty strict rules, though, about like if you're undergoing transition, hormones, because it falls under issues of, could fall under banned substances, that you can't take the field. And so in a way, that's another form of normalization, and that they're trying to have a very broad umbrella about banned substances, from Adderall, so you're not staying up all night lifting weights, to hormones you might be taking as part of transition. So like, for example, I know Courtney's here from GW there. And I wrote several articles and did some panels with Kai Allams, who he played on the GW women's team. He was the first trans Division I athlete ever in the NCAA. And you know, we spoke about this issue a great deal, that he was allowed to be able to call himself Kai, to be referred to as he. And at the same time, hormones were off the table until after the season ended, or any sort of actual transition was off the table until after the season ended. So, but the bigger question, though, and this is where it gets to where you get a lot of the transphobia, is question of sports like wrestling and mixed martial arts, where there is a lot of junk science about bone density and about people who are male to female and about advantages that gives them. And a lot of that is hooey that's made up for the purposes of keeping trans athletes in the closet, so to speak. But we got so far to go on this issue that we're just scratching the surface.
Really quickly, wouldn't you consider like banning hormones for men and women? Like, wouldn't you consider that a form of transphobia? And what is it going to take mm-hmm. for those to be taken off of the ban list? Because I can't survive without like my estrogen.
Exactly. No, that's the next step, definitely. And the NCAA, the way they're trying to deal with it is to have these broad umbrellas on hormones as a way to, they think it's a way towards normalization. What they're not doing, which they need to do, is to look at what actually does aid performance versus what is being done for survival purposes.
Thank you.
But I will say this too. This discussion is so important about trans athletes for the reason I said before, in that it challenges this idea of why we even divide people up, boys and girls, on sports to begin with. I mean, there's so, now I'm not saying people shouldn't be classified for the purposes of competition, but why do we choose that as our point of classification?
Most definitely.
You know, I mean, there's so many other ways we could do it. Height, strength, you know, there's so many different ways if we really want to classify to weight, of course, which is done in boxing and mixed martial arts. There's so many different ways we could do it. And this way that we do it is arbitrary, and it stretches back to a time where women were simply denied the right to play. And so for their ability to play, they had to form their own teams just to have the right to play. That's the bigger question to me.
Thank you so much.
It's great to see you from DC.
Just two more questions, you.
My name is Derek Robertson. I'm a grad student in Northwestern, and this is a two-part question, but I'll keep each part very simple. The first part is, how do you face the challenge of communicating such an opaque but important issue as stadium financing? And second, De'Aaron Fox or Dennis Smith Jr.?
Second what?
De'Aaron Fox or Dennis Smith Jr.?
Oh.
Markel Fultz.
Yeah, I was going to say Markel Fultz.
This is a second choice question.
Lonzo Ball. Josh Jackson. There's kind of a long list I have before those names.
My roommate's a Knicks fan. Sorry.
Okay. Josh Jackson. I'm sorry. We're naming very exploited
very
college basketball players.
We got to wrap up.
And the question, stadium funding is an issue. God, I've been writing about that as long as I've been writing about sports. The main issue, how you write about it, first and foremost, is you look at the question of public financing. Where is it? Is it happening? It doesn't happen in every case. Second question you want to look at is offsets. If there is public financing, are they doing something as some cities have done because the PR around this is so terrible? Are they doing like for every $1 in the stadium, $1 is going to go to repair roads or libraries or something like that? So you're looking for offsets. The third thing you want to look at in places like San Francisco or Philadelphia, where they've said, oh, there's no public financing at all. This is all private because we don't want to get into the whole corporate welfare thing. It's you want to look at, are they getting massive tax breaks? So it really is public financing, even if they call it private. So that's the things you want to look at. And yes, they try to make it very opaque. But no, it doesn't have to be opaque. You follow the money and say, is our taxpayers underwriting these monuments to corporate welfare that are publicly funded stadiums?
Thank you.
Thanks.
Second question, Dave. Second question.
Oh, no, it was the...
Dennis.
I said that one already. Markel Fultz.
Okay, I'm sorry. Thank you for the question. Our last question, please.
Okay, I'll preface this with saying I don't know that much about pro sports, but
names, please. Names. What's your name?
Oh, I'm Beatrice.
Hey, Beatrice.
And I go to Clark University in Massachusetts. And I recently read the book Invisible Man Got the Whole World Watching by Michael Denzel Smith, who I believe was a fellow at the Nation.
Yeah, he was, and that was actually a Nation book and one that we're very proud of. So
yeah.
Thank you for reading that.
It was a wonderful Nation book.
Everyone else should check that out.
Yeah, it's very good. But he talks about pro athletes and, you know, political activism within pro athletics, and something he referenced was $40 million slaves,
sure.
The book. And I was wondering, like, if you could just share your thoughts on that and what you think it would actually take to, like, if you think that will ever be addressed or if any athletes have tried to address that issue.
Address what in particular?
Just the fact, like, I guess if you could touch on, like, what your thoughts are on the whole idea behind that book. And like the idea of...
And it's very relevant for right now as we're talking about the NCAA, which is basically this constitutional free zone of indentured servitude for athletes. And $40 Million Slaves, it's a great book. It's by William Roden. And one of the things the book is about the continuity of sports under conditions of slavery to sports today, where athletes, obviously many black athletes make very huge salaries, but the question that he looks at, which is what makes it so powerful, is the question of power. And not just about the money in your check, but who actually controls the levers of sports, who benefits from the exploitation of black bodies, how does that process work? It's a very good book. And to me, it's an important book to answer a question that just came up with Andre Iguodala of the Golden State Warriors, where he got all, like, it was like a media firestorm because he called Steve Kerr, his coach, a master in the locker room, and with sort of like a roll of his eyes. And it was interesting, like the people who lined up to criticize him were from obviously white sports writers, but also a group of, you know, very, very high profile black sports writers were like, this is an outrage. How dare you compare being a pro athlete to slavery? And Bill Roden actually wrote a piece for The Undefeated, and I've written stuff about this in the past, that's not the key question. The key question is why historically, and this goes back to Jack Johnson, Kurt Flood, Oscar Robertson, NCAA athletes today, why black athletes reach for this metaphor in the first place? Why is it when Warren Sapp, he talked about playing for the NFL as being a form of slavery, and he said, it's not just slavery for white people, look at my quarterback, and he was talking about his quarterback, Chris Sims, who in the game that previous week was put back into the game with a ruptured spleen and later had to have his spleen removed in an emergency and almost died on the field. And it's this idea of not saying that playing pro sports is like a plantation, but it is like saying who has power, who doesn't, who gets to make decisions and who doesn't. And when you look at who actually is in the owner's boxes in the world of sports, I think the answer reveals itself very clearly. And when you look at the cabal of billionaires who run the NFL, many of whom, most of whom, gave huge fortunes to Donald Trump, and you look at the fact that Colin Kaepernick still doesn't have a job, that's why athletes reach for that metaphor.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, on that note, I know we could talk forever about this, as we could have so many other things, but we're going to end this session. Thank you, Dave.